My name is Andrés Vindas Meléndez, and I'm a National Science Foundation postdoctoral research fellow at the University of California, Berkeley. I don't think math was natural to me when I was young. In fact, I struggled with subtraction as a little kid. And I think part of that was because it was a language barrier. So I was originally in a bilingual kindergarten class, and I went to a bilingual first grade class. But those bilingual in quotations actually it was completely taught in Spanish. And so when I moved to the second grade, I had a very difficult time. And so there was a language difference and a language barrier when I was learning subtraction. And I didn't learn subtraction properly until my aunt taught it to me in Spanish. And so it wasn't even my teacher, it was my aunt. So it didn't always come naturally to me, but I enjoyed it. Once I understood the concept, right? I think I started finding it fascinating. I actually wanted to be a high school math teacher for the longest time. And it wasn't until I got to my undergrad institution that I learned that people get paid to do mathematics mathematics research. And so it was in part because of some programs that I was involved in, for example, the Cal New Experiences for Research and Diversity in Science. So Cal Nerds was a program that presented me the research opportunities to do as an undergraduate. And I learned, okay, well, there's such a thing as a PhD, a doctorate that you can do and get paid to be a mathematics researcher. And so I think it was when I hit undergrad and that opportunity was presented to do mathematics research that I wanted to be a mathematician. But I'd say that I've always wanted to be a mathematics teacher because I had amazing mathematics, middle school and high school math teachers, all of who were Black and Latinx. And so I knew that there was a concept of a mathematician and that, you know, people from underrepresented communities can do mathematics. And so I think a mixture of those two things, you know, got me to thinking I could be a mathematician. I work in algebraic and geometric combinatorics. And so I love to share kind of three definitions that are given by people. One of them was by my master's thesis advisor, Federico Ardila, who has also participated in the Meet a Mathematician videos. And he says that combinatorics is the study of possibilities. I guess the second definition is by a professor from UCLA, Igor Peck, who says it's like the branch of mathematics that concerns itself with counting and characterizing and classifying and listing things. And then the last definition that I like to present is by Josephine Yu at Georgia, who's a professor at Georgia Tech. And she says that combinatorics is the art and science. So the art and science of distilling a complex mathematical structure into smaller, simple attributes. And then from those smaller, simple attributes, you develop a deeper understanding of the original structure. And so that's what combinatorics to me, you know, mix of those three definitions is kind of how I view and work in combinatorics. I work with some combinatorial and geometric objects called polytopes. And so what are polytopes? Polytopes are higher generalizations of polygons. And so we've seen polygon squares, triangles, anything that you can draw on a paper that's, you know, convex. And then we think about them in higher dimension. And so we get, you get higher dimensional figures. So you get some cubes and some nice shapes. And so you can enumerate their number of faces, their edges, their vertices. So those are very combinatorial and geometric properties. Now, what if you put a polytope on a lattice or a grid? Then you can count as integer points. And there's plenty that can be done with counting integer points. And this area the study of enumeration of lattice points is called Earhart theory. And it has connections to plenty of areas, different areas of mathematics, algebraic geometry, commutative algebra, even to the sciences, because polytopes arise in nature, you know, through crystals and crystallography. And then more recently, there's been people applying Earhart theory to voting techniques. So, you know, there's different, there's little pieces that come in where you're surprised in the connections. So I'd say this is a geometric combinatorics is an area that ties in combinatorics and discrete geometry. One struggle was I chose all my mathematics courses as an undergrad wrong. I didn't know what I wanted to do. And in fact, it's a difficulty, but not necessarily a struggle, but I chose to follow my friends because I needed, you know, it's a difficulty in academia is finding people who you feel comfortable, who represent your community. And so I found friends who were applied mathematicians, and I had no intention of doing applied math. But if you look at my coursework, I did ODEs, PDEs, numerical analysis. Like I was taking all the applied classes because I had friends who were from, you know, underrepresented communities in the mathematics community. And I was like, I need that community to be able to succeed as an undergrad. So that was a difficulty because I was really interested in, you know, a more pure or, you know, combinatorics was a stronghold at my undergrad institution at the time. And I didn't do combinatorics until way later in my mathematical career. I guess on a more personal level, some difficulties and struggle is that I was diagnosed with a chronic illness as a doctoral student, and I was hospitalized, and I ended up missing some written prelim exams, and that, you know, eventually I had to take later on during my doctoral work. And I really struggled with the idea that I wanted to accomplish and finish all my mathematical and educational goals, but I couldn't accomplish those goals if my health wasn't good. And my mind could not grasp that. And so I felt I became very anxious and struggled with depression because of this. And you can't do mathematics and you can't build community if you're not healthy. And so it's been years that it's still an ongoing process of learning to value and respect my body and listen to my body, and my body was giving me physical signs that I needed to stop and take a break or stop and learn to eat properly, to sleep properly, to exercise. And so it took a long time. I also got diagnosed with ADHD as an adult, and that has been a struggle because now you're not only am I combating, you know, mental health, and but you're also combating these physical manifestations of stress and attention. And so those have been struggles, and but I feel like I'm, you know, adversity, it has been there since day one, and I've made it this far, and I'm still learning and growing, but I've done this with the support of a lot of people. Some of the proudest accomplishments, let's see. I think finishing my PhD was one of my proudest accomplishments, given what I've shared about, you know, enduring some illness and mental health issues and things like this. I still sometimes sit down on my desk and I'm like, wow, you finished a whole PhD. How did you do that? Because as a postdoc, what am I supposed to be doing? I'm very proud of my research papers because I can say that I get to choose who I get to do math with. I value the people I work with more than the actual mathematics that gets produced. And it just so happens that I produce beautiful mathematics with amazing people. So I'm very, very proud and accomplished that I've done, you know, that I've written several papers now with amazing people. The supporting people, I think, were my parents. I think when we talk about supporting people, my advocates from day one were my parents. I remember not being placed in certain math classes or in the gifted and talented education programs. And my mom would go into the office and say, like, hey, you've placed my son in the wrong courses. as a master's student, I was fortunate to have be co-advised by Federico Ardila and Matthias Beck at San Francisco State. And I will still call them and talk to them, and they'll know what's going on in my life. And sometimes I just have to let somebody know some, you know, updates or things that are going on. And through my PhD, my supporting person was my PhD advisor, who I care for dearly, like Benjamin Braun. I would not have finished my PhD without the care and support of my PhD advisor. I think even to this day, I think like these three mathematicians, they might not know it, but they're going to continue supporting me, hopefully. You know, sometimes we hear very negative stories about the culture of mathematics and mathematicians. And I've had plenty of interactions with people that weren't so kind, but I like to highlight that I've been very fortunate to surround myself with amazing mathematicians. And again, this is something that I get to choose, right? I get to choose who I surround myself with. And, you know, people that have that I've met at SACMES, that I've met at just by participating in different conferences. Combinatorialists are some of the nicest mathematicians I know. Just, you know, shout out to my combinatorialists. I'm very fortunate that they've been supportive of me and my family. I call my sisters and my cousins and my godparents, and everybody has supported me from day one. You know, I don't know who to talk about role models. Because there's probably too many. Check out testimonial stories of Latinx and Hispanic mathematicians, because those are all role models and people that I respect. I've been fortunate. In the spirit of Lizzo, if you're shining, everybody's gonna shine. And I really do think once you focus on yourself, you can really start making a difference with other people. And I guess I'll speak to maybe the younger career mathematicians like myself, is we often have mentor-mentee relationships, but we have the power and autonomy to like to choose our mentors, to choose who gets to be part of our community. And so preserve your energy and give your love and your energy to the people that will actually value it.